More EFTs, I guess.
All right, thank you so much. Thank you to the organizers for inviting me. What I'm going to talk about today is based on this work that was done in collaboration with Gabriele Franciolini in Geneva, Lam Hui and Lucas Antonio, and Enrico Dini in Paris. Now, so to motivate what one is going to do. However, after Enrico and Paolo's talk, it's more depending on away with a much shorter introduction. All right, so the main idea is observation of computational waves provided by the new wind to test and take advantage of this opportunity as much as possible to test as can, and by the system of new degrees of freedom. Now, this is the full waveform of one such event, usually conventionally subdivided into three parts, the one that is originated from the incidental phase, the highly nonlinear merger process, and lastly, the down process where the final black hole settles down to equilibrium. And what I'm going to focus on is going to be this last part, namely the ring down, and relatively simple case with a special, with a particular test of the gravitational sector. So why focus particularly on the ring? Well, Enrico gave some good this morning. Let me just add a couple of points to that. I think it is interesting both from a theoretical perspective and an experimental one. From a theoretical viewpoint, there is a lot that we can improve on. So typically, when studying breakdown in modified theories of gravity, is they take a particular Lagrangian for a scalar tensor theory, derive a black solution, perturb these black hole solutions, study the spectrum of normal modes, so forth. Really not a systematic way to go about it if you want to systematically test the gravitational sector. Now, from an experimental point, while now we only have access to a couple of quasi normal modes, future gravitational wave detectors are supposed to be able to have access to allow us to carry out black hole spectroscopy, namely of these frequencies with the predictions of GR and check for deviations. All right, so in this talk, I'm going to focus, as I said, in a, on a very particular and special setup, and I will discuss an effective theory for ring down of static balls, so not spinning, and in theories where the gravitational sector has only an additional scalar degrees of freedom. Okay, both of these restrictions, in principle, could be relaxed, but that would be much more complicated. And we just have to get a handle of this simpler setup first. And as I motivate in a moment, it will be pretty natural to see that just static black holes, but actually black holes that have a scalar hair. All right, so before we get there, let me just review very briefly how one usually does the spectrum of quasi holes for standard Schwarzschild black holes. Okay? So what does is works in black hole perturbation theory, meaning consider small perturbations around the Schwarzschild metric, which I'm calling G bar. And as we usually do when we say perturbations in cosmology, what we want to do is break up these perturbations into components that transform into the symmetries that are unbroken. So on an FRW background, this allows us to expand our perturbations in Fourier modes. That's what homogeneity buys us. And then isotropy allows us to decompose perturbations into scalar vectors and tensors. So here, a spherically symmetric background is static, and that means we can expand perturbations in Fourier modes with time. And is spherically symmetric, so we can expand. And then the only thing that we can use to break up perturbations, there is no more classification into scalar vectors and tensors, only break them according to parity transformation, as Enrico already mentioned. So in particular, that means that out of the 10 perturbations, we can break them into 3 that are odd under parity and 7 that are even under parity. And of course, the usual and not all of the are physical, as we know. And in each of these sectors, there is only, at the end of the day, when the dust goes, 1 physical degrees of freedom. And you can think of these 2 polarizations. Okay, so because the odd and even perturbations decouple, we can break them up and study them separately. And in each of these sectors, we can massage and combine them to end up in each sector with a single linearized equation that has the same form as a Schrodinger equation. Okay? Where now you have 1 potential in the odd sector and a different potential in the odd sector. And this radial coordinate R is a tortoise coordinate. So what we want to do when we study quasi-normal modes is solve the Schrodinger equations with the boundary conditions that correspond to having an infalling wave at the horizon and no outgoing wave, which just corresponds to the fact that classically nothing should come out of outgoing wave, which corresponds to the fact that we're interested in the problem where we're not probing our black hole with some incoming wave, we're just looking at an isolated black hole that is relaxing. Okay, so under these conditions, equations for which are labeled by 2 integers, an on n and the angular momentum number l. And interestingly, in d equal 4, as Enrico already mentioned, even though these 2 potentials are different in the even and the odd sector, the spectra of quasi-normal modes in the even and odd sector are exactly the same. And this can be understood as being a consequence of some version of an electric that the even and odd sector. So this potential here for Schwarzschild is known analytically, and it only depends. But still, the Schrodinger equation is too complicated to be solved. And so what it actually does is solve it numerically, like this. So the line has to guide the eye. What I'm showing here are the quasi-normal modes for L equal 2 and L equal 3 for a Schwarzschild black hole in the complex plane. And one feature that I want to point out, which is going to be I'm going to come up back to later, is that if you look at how the real part of the quasi-normal mode changes, the real part depends much more strongly on L than it does on the overtone N. Vice versa, the imaginary part depends. Okay, I still have time, right? Okay. The imaginary part depends much more strongly on N than it does on L, okay? So the fact that all these frequencies have negative part in my conventions just amounts to the fact that and the fact that the imaginary part grows with N more rapidly tells you that modes with higher and higher N are going to be more and more damped, and so people are going to be harder to observe in the future than modes with higher L, for which the real part is the one that changes more drastically. So, this changes if you add scalar field in the rotational sector. And in principle, this picture can change. Of course, you expect a set of quasi-normal frequencies. You could break this isospectrality modes more drastically, you could add some mixing with the even between the even and odd sector. Perturbations together at the same time. Now, as Enrico pointed out, this first modification is really sensitive to the coupling that you are assuming between this extra mode and whereas in a sense these are a bit robust. And moreover, a very nice paper by Ferreira, Lagos, and Tattersall shows if you have a scalar that has a trivial profile, modes with the set of frequencies that you predict from GR, but always also the ones that you predict from GR. And so from this viewpoint, another way of phrasing that is that out of four, these three possible modifications require a scalar hair. And so that's why I'm going to focus on many familiar with the fact that there are many no good theorems on the market for static black holes. Theorems all based on some assumptions, and assumptions can be biased. And so, for example, we know as a proof of principle that if we consider a scalar tensor theory with a non-minimal coupling that involves some higher derivative operators, such as a Chern-Simons term or a Gauss-Bonnet term, that these theories do a scalar. And so another way of what I'm going to talk about is to say, instead of relying on assumptions and theorems, just try to test experimentally for the existence of a scalar hair. Okay, so to do that, I'm going to introduce an EFT framework for perturbations around black holes with scalar hair. And I'm going to follow or dark hair. And by going to unitary gauge. And that's always that, that's something that we can do precisely because we are considering a scalar field that has a. When that is the case, to set. Sorry. And once we have done that, our theory should only be invariant under the residual diffs, namely. In general, the Lagrangian is going to be a function of this form. Of course, it's going to contain things that are honest tensors under all diffs, but also the contravariant component, RR components of the metric, and the extrinsic curvature of the surfaces of plus arbitrary dependence on the radius. Okay? So essentially what this scalar profile does is picking for preferred. Okay, now, and expand them in perturbation around some background value. And now for the aficionados of the EFT of inflation, I should emphasize that this step here technically is a bit different from the one that is done usually in EFT of inflation of dark energy, meaning that in our case, it is not possible to carry out the splitting in a way that the residual diffs. Okay? And this has to do with the fact that that in the EFT of inflation, slices of constant time are maximally symmetries, and whereas and this allows you to write down, for instance, to express the extrinsic curvature as a function of the induced metric, whereas in our case, okay, so we have fewer symmetry, and so we are unable to perform the splitting in a gauge invariant. However, I want to argue that this is not The only difference is that when I'm going to, well, I will show it now to you, when I'm going to write down an effective perturbations, the perturbation that I'm going to be is going to depend on the gauge that I'm working. The terms are always going to be the same, but if I use this action to constrain some of these arbitrary coefficients that appear in the Lagrangian, they are going to depend on the gauge that I'm working with. And so I need to keep track of that. Yeah.
With an eye on cosmology, one could be interested to add a time-like gradient to the field. And I guess it would be also possible in some Galilean theories, just because adding a gradient is a symmetry.
Yeah.
So can you put this into your formalism? Is it hard to do it? Is it very different?
No, I think it... Now, I and so interesting. Okay, so equations up to quadratic and up to quadratic order in derivatives. Of course, in here there are also higher order in perturbations, but here I'm writing all the terms that contribute to quadratic order. Terms that I'm neglecting with the dots start contributing a cubic. Okay. It contains a bunch of free functions of R, although not all these coefficients are. Neglect coupling with other matter. This coefficient in front of the Ricci tensor can eliminate with transformation. Whereas F1 and F2 and F3 are fixed by demanding that the background is a solution to the equation of motion. So each of these provide a tadpole, and the fact that here we have three tadpoles as opposed to two, like in the case of EFT, the fact that in our setup we have fewer symmetries on the slices of constant R. Very good. Notice a question that someone asked to Paolo earlier. I haven't written all the terms, but in all these terms, you can show that at quadratic order in derivatives, one cannot write down any term that includes an epsilon tensor. And this tells you that at quadratic order in derivatives on the perturbations, there is not going to be a kinetic mixing between the odd and the even sector, one of the possible modifications that I mentioned earlier, is bound to higher derivative effect. Okay, so in principle, energy is one start with a set of operators, this effective action, perturbation, like equations. Okay, so already at this stage, I would like to say that this approach is quite convenient in practice, because if you have two particular scalar tensor theories, two particular Lagrangians, you can match them onto this effective Lagrangian, and as long as you are keeping all the relevant operators in the Lagrangian, you can carry out this operation once. Usually it's fairly labor intensive to derive these Schrödinger-like equations. So you can do it once for a set of operators in the Lagrangian, and then you don't need to do it for any theory. You can just match directly onto the Schrödinger equation. So at this stage, this is fairly convenient and something that is even more interesting is to use this effect of Lagrangian to impose constraints on the functions that appear in here when you don't know, without making any assumptions about the particular black hole solution. Okay. This is where we, at first, we seem to run into some problems. That's because this effect of Lagrangian contains so when you go to do that, through this exercise and then Schrodinger-like equations, potentials for the even and for the odd modes are these arbitrary functions. And so in principle, you would think that what you end up with are just some arbitrary potentials. Don't seem to indicate any gross departure from general relativity. Okay, and so carry out this program, we're gonna need two extra steps. So the first step is a WKB approximation.
About the gauge invariance. So, yeah. So you said that obviously you couldn't write it all in a manifestly invariant way. So, but of course, it's still there. It must be there at some level, right? So I mean, how does it manifest itself at all? Like, how do you see it? Is there some constraint that you...
No, so, in fact, there is no constraint in the sense that you can show that any Lagrangian, such as the one that I wrote down, can be produced from a Lagrangian that is invariant under all the residual diffs up to terms that are of higher order in perturbations. And so, in this sense, by just writing down everything we can without worrying about the residual diffs, we are not being more general than we're allowed to. Okay. So that's basically. Yeah, it's right. Okay, so what I'm showing you here is the potential for the L equal to which has generically has a maximum at a location that I'm gonna call R star. This maximum depends I'm going to call this value R star zero abuse of terminology, and though that really applies only in the L equal to infinity limit. So the problem essentially that we're interested in solving is finding a solution to the Schrodinger equation where we said we only have wave going out to infinity, wave going into the horizon, okay? Now, let's say, imagine that you're trying to solve a quantum mechanics problem starting from a potential barrier. Transmitted wave, and that is smaller than the incoming or reflected waves because it has to tunnel the barrier. Okay? The condition of where you only have a reflected wave and a transmitted wave, and you want the two to have roughly a comparable amplitude, then these modes should have a frequency that lives somewhere around the top of this potential. Region. And then they matched it near the top by approximating the potential just with a quadratic potential. And by matching these two WKB solutions together, what they found was a quantization condition for the frequency, which depends on the potential and the similar condition that you find. Okay, because we actually know how to solve what this approximation is, the accuracy is of the percent level on the real part and sub-percent level on the imaginary part. More importantly, you find that the accuracy actually moves with higher level. Okay, and this is used for us because, like I argued before, those are the modes that you have the best hope to measure. And for information,
Okay. So because our observation right now are comparable, seems to be comparable with GR, what we are going to assume is that we're gonna make a quasi-Schwarzschild approximation, which in practical terms means we're gonna assume that the position of the maximum of the potential doesn't differ by much from the position of the maximum of the potential in GR. Okay, so that this delta R star is small. And because this R star of GR, fantastic, thank you, super efficient.
All right. Because this R star of GR, in turn, it's approximately constant, we are going to assume that the true R star at lowest order is also approximately constant. And now, with this extra assumption, indeed, we are calculating the potential for all different L's in this expression at one single point at lowest order. And so we can get an expression for the quasi-normal frequency that only depends on the potential, quasi-normal potential, and the second derivative evaluated at a single point for all L's and all N, okay? Of course, though, if you are particularly picky, this is an approximation that you can improve upon by including higher orders. And those higher order terms are going to involve just higher derivatives of the quasi-normal mode potentials evaluated at the same point.
formalism with the events that we actually observe. The most urgent one is to extend these to spinning solutions. So when you consider spinning black holes, of course, you reduce even more the symmetries, and so in principle, even more perturbation, operators are going to be allowed on any ordering derivatives and perturbations. But it would also be important to include matter couplings, so add additional matter fields. And that's something for which we have a blueprint that's also done, for instance, when you go from the if you have single field inflation to multi-field inflation. And finally, it would be nice to use this framework to see whether we can say something different, have a different perspective on why it is in general so difficult to come up with black hole solutions with scalar hair, and it is so easy to come up with no theorems. So this is still a work in progress, so let me stop here, and thank you for your attention.
Okay, any questions? Oh yeah, okay, follow up.
Sorry, I have a general question. So I have problems to understand what does it mean to measure quasi-normal modes in a precise sense. In a sense, since these are not a complete set of modes, so is there some blurred... So it's not like decomposing a function and looking at Fourier frequency, no? Because they so is there some intrinsic blurriness when I say I measure quasi-normal modes, or... In a sense, they do not capture everything about the response, no?
So I should premise that I'm not an expert in the conservation, but as far as I understand, the fact that they're not a complete set just means that, they're not a complete set, and they also have a different problem, which is that when you look at the spatial profile, because you have a complex frequency, the fact that your mode decays in time, it also means that on one side or the other, it's going to blow up exponentially. And so because of that, you cannot reconstruct solutions that existed at all times and that are random. However, I think there is no problem in decomposing a signal if it has a finite duration, if it starts at some time. That's my understanding, but there are probably people in the audience that are more expert.
Often it's not a problem.
I think there's a question over here, right?
So if we take the analogy between effective field theory of inflation and the black holes with scalar hair seriously, I was just wondering if what would you expect for a rotating black hole? Could it be like do you expect something like a vector hair for those setups? Because, for example, in that's like an inflationary setup in Bianchi background.
Oh, is that not? Oh, God, I have to get fit here.
They're making you exercise. All right. So, no, it's a very good question. So, as I said before, I think if you consider a background, a black hole background that is spinning now, you're going to, of course, break isotropy. And so, in general, you're going to. You're going to be able to write many more terms in the effective Lagrangian compared to the ones that I wrote down. Now, on top of that, you could ask what happens if instead of having a preferred foliation due to a scalar hair, you have a preferred foliation due to a vector hair, and in which case you also have to consider which symmetries are broken by this vector. Presumably what we've done here could also be generalized to that case. But of course, by having a vector, you would also add new degrees of freedom now. So, yeah.
Could you capture slow rotation in your form?
As a perturbation, yes. But I think there is a subtlety that the modes that are physical here are the ones that starts with L equal 2, L equal 0, and L equal 1. You can gauge them away. Now, if I remember correctly, if you take a rotating background as a perturbation of Schwarzschild, that perturbation is actually an L equal one perturbation. And so at least that tells you that you cannot think of that perturbation as just giving a VEV to the perturbations that we're considering here. Yeah.
Any more questions?
So one of the fun fact about the EFT of inflation is that you can bring back, of course, as you know very well, the Goldstone boson, and that field makes manifest the nonlinear realization of the spontaneously broken symmetry, and you get fun things like the speed of sound is related to non-Gaussianity. Here it seems that you might not get as much mileage because the things that eventually you will be interested in will be the helicity two, so the tensors. And those don't care so much about how this symmetry is non-linearly realized. So I'm trying to understand this. Is there this formalism, does it help you with the symmetries, or you just use it because it's a convenient way to write many models, but you're never going to look at cubic terms? And
yeah, so it's a very good point. I think in this setup, as far as I understand, all you're interested in is the quadratic action, so linear perturbations, because non-linearities are just hopelessly small. So from that viewpoint, that's true. On the other hand, when you are interested in more formal applications, for instance, studying stability of certain solutions, if you want to study stability in the small wavelength limit, then it can make sense to reintroduce the Goldstone, and you can look at the coupling limit essentially. But if you look at sufficiently small scales, but that I think that has to do more with more formal applications than exactly.
Just while he's setting up, we'll get a question from Elias.
For your black holes, the quasi-normal rows usually have a gap. But we know that for Schwarzschild, there is a limit in which the gap goes to zero. And then the effective theory is hydrodynamics. And when you add scalars, it's known that it is forced hydrodynamics. Do you know how this interpolates with the theory you're studying?
No. So to be honest, it's a very good question. I haven't thought about it. It would be very interesting to look into that.
Still setting up, so you can have more questions.
So when you talk about closeness to GR, and I guess you define being close to GR by postulating that the quasi-normal modes only depends on the values of your coefficient at some given R star and the derivatives of these coefficients, right? So But is there any other way? Is there any other way of saying, okay, so this works if the post-Newtonian correction to GR is smaller than such and such? I mean,
I don't know. Meaning that the quasi-normal modes are also sensitive close to the horizon, not just to what happens far away from the black hole. Something that I just wanted to comment on, because the way in which we define this quasi-Schwarzschild approximation is really by saying you want the light ring not to change by much. What I didn't mention is that you could say, but you can always redefine the radial coordinate as you want. So how is that meaningful? But there is one choice of radial coordinate that makes the equations in a Schrödinger form. If you redefine the radial coordinate, then it doesn't have that form anymore. And so when I say I want R star not to change by much, is in coordinates such that I have a Schrödinger-like equation. Yeah. But I don't know if that answered your question, so maybe we can talk more offline.
Okay, thanks. Let's thank Ricardo again. Okay, so now we got Lam, who's going to be the last talk of the day.
Thank you.